Yo, 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 it's your boy, Melly Mel, a.k.a. King Joffy, one-third of G.M.S. And welcome to the podcast, good people. I hope you enjoy.
What's up, everybody? This is your boy, GQ Smooth, coming at you live out of Raleigh, North Carolina, man. This is G.M.S. Podcast, where we come at you live weekly with raw and uncut content. Man, I'm so excited for this, man, for you guys. We got a lot of stuff in store for you. GMS, y'all know what it is. Let's get it.
What's going on, people? I'm one of your co-hosts, Shahid, a.k.a. Triple M, a.k.a. Maximize Motivational Muscles, a.k.a. Mr. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, man himself. And I want you guys to tune in. That's right. Tune in to GMS, Grown Man Subjects. We talk about everything from sports, news, politics, entrepreneurship. We have great content coming for you guys, so get ready and subscribe.
What's going on, guys? What's going on? We are back with another episode of Maximize Grown Man Subjects. I'm one of your co-hosts, Shahid, aka Triple M.
What's good, people? It's your boy King Joffy, aka Melly Mel. What's happening?
What's good, everybody? It's your boy GQ Smooth, man. Let's get right into these great topics we got for y'all today.
Rock, let's rock, man. So boom, first topic we got, Jason Kidd to the Mavericks. Now we all know Jason Kidd, first ballot Hall of Famer, right? We know that he had the championship with the Dallas Mavericks. What was that, back in 2011. And, I mean, we know that, man. When we look at J. Kidd, man, he's one of the point guards of the NBA. How is that going to affect Luka? We all know is the franchise piece. Without him, you don't have no Dallas Mavericks. So how you guys feel about that?
Yeah, I like it. I like it. Jay Kidd is one of my favorite point guards. So, you know, I'm a little biased. I'm going to root for anything that he kind of does. But, you know, we seen him head coach the Milwaukee Bucks in the Brooklyn Nets at one point in time. And he wasn't exactly successful. I think he had like a below 500 record, if I'm not mistaken. You know, those teams, it was a young Giannis, it was a young Bucks team. Brooklyn, I forget exactly what he was working with then. I think he had Brook Lopez and a couple guys. But, you know, going into, you know, this Dallas team organization, I feel like it's very well structured. They got obviously a young superstar to build off of. So, I don't know. I think this might be a good fit for J. Kidd. I like it.
Mm. Yeah, me too. I feel the same way, man. Like you said, he won a championship with them back in 2011. Mm-hmm. One of the star, you know, players to help them win that year. And I think they had a great relationship with Jason Kidd. You know, I think he also played with them prior to playing that championship team when he first started off in his career. So it makes sense. He's been with that organization for quite some time. When you look at the total years he's been there, he has a great relationship with Luka, from what I hear also. And I think Barea is trying to get on the coaching staff as well. Mm. He has a great relationship with him as well. And Barea has a great relationship with Luka as well. So I think that goes well for Luka and the rest of the guys on that team. Look at his one championship experience. I mean, that's what they need. That guy who knows what it takes to get there. Not only that, he went against LeBron and Dwayne and Chris Bosh. So he knows like how to deal with adversity, dealing with a stacked team like that. Mm-hmm. I mean, that was a tough ring to get, but he was able to beat them with Dirk and Jason Terry and all those guys. So I feel like this is gonna be a good fit. We'll see, you know, what kind of strategies to come up with, you know, for Luka. So far, Luka's proven to be pretty much unstoppable, man. It's just the people around him need to step up more. So we'll see how Jason Kidd, you know, manages that. And I'm sure he's going to figure it out. And yeah, it's going to be a great fit for him.
Man, you know, we always like, you know, those great point guards to, at one point in time, become coaches because the way they facilitate and see the floor from – that perspective is damn near perfect. You know, So I'm very excited for him. J Kidd, now, like you said, man, when it comes to, you know, early 2000s and, you know, going out of his prime, man, he was considered, you know, top three point guard in the league, top five point guard in the league, and top 10 point guard in the league, man, even after his prime, man. So much salute to J Kidd. And like you said, man, it was a young Giannis, man. So I was a young team, you know. I think even Brandon Knight was on it, man. So, you know, young team, yeah. Man. And I don't think that they put him in a position for success, you know, like not to bring race into it, but hey, man, if you were to give somebody a Steve Nash, he's walking into a KD and Kyrie. I feel like you automatically set up for success to a certain degree, you know, versus somebody like a Chauncey Billups, who I pray that he gets that Portland job, to where, you know, he's stepping into a team where, you know, you got Damian Lillard, you know, so, you know, much salute to those guys, man, because they at least have a starter piece, man. So much salute, man. I definitely was the best for him. Jumping into the second topic, man, Ben Simmons, man. Ah, man, I know the Philly crowd. Philly is not forgiving, you know. Unless you AI, you know, Philly crowd is not forgiving, man. And over the course of his playoff career, Ben Simmons have averaged 13.9 points a game, 8 rebounds, 7.5 assists. I don't know exactly where any of those stats were in this playoff against ATL. But what's a good landing place for him and his development?
That's a great question. I actually thought about this quite some time last night, just thinking about what would be the best situation for him. Previously, I was watching First Take this week, and Stephen A. mentioned somebody from Philly actually sending him a text saying that Ben doesn't work. He's constantly babied. He's around family too much, this and that. I don't know how true those statements are, but going off that one statement alone that he doesn't work, if that's true, I don't see any destination he can go to where he'll develop if he doesn't put in the work. With that being said, though, I feel like Golden State would be a great place. And here's why. You got three guys who are established. Stephen Curry, Klay Thompson, Draymond Green. We've heard their credibility about how much work they put in and how much about their work they have put in since, you know, joining that team. And look at Stephen. I know the work he puts in. He was talking after he got eliminated from the play-in. He was on live with J. Cole. And J. Cole asked him, well, how long does it take, you know, for you to, you know, get the rest and get back into work? He said about 3 weeks. And he's back at it. So, you know, that's work. And Klay Thompson, you know, he's putting in the work to get back 200% next season. And, you know, Draymond Green puts in the work as well. So I feel like with that and being around those guys, he can't help. But if that's the case that he doesn't put in work, it's going to be contagious for him to just, you know, automatically, you know, want to put in that work because he can be around guys that constantly do it. And these are guys that won championships as well. So being around that atmosphere as well will, I feel like, encourage him to, you know, step up his work ethic if that's the case. So I feel like Golden State would be a perfect landing spot for him.
Okay. We got one Golden State. Where could another possible landing spot be, Mel?
Yeah, I like that Golden State pick too. I actually had them on the list. I had like three teams. They were on the list. And a lot of the reasons G touched on, but I feel like Ben Simmons, if he can go there and kind of just learn what Draymond does and you know, buy into being like a six man, I think he could really fit there. That might be a good fit for him. I also had we talked about him, but Portland. Now, you know, contract wise, they would have to make some changes and probably get rid of like CJ McCollum. But I feel like that's probably somebody that they can use. I like CJ McCollum, but you know, he's more of a half court scorer. You know, he can get a bucket and whatnot. But one thing the Trailblazers have been lacking is defense. So you get an all NBA defensive player on that team, somebody that could kind of push the break, get a little more fast break points, make the game a little bit easier. that could be a good fit for him. So I like him in Portland. And then I had the other team I had up there was a Portland and Charlotte, man. Just being biased, I would just like to see him in Charlotte with LaMelo. I'm not even gonna lie. Just a young team. I feel like they could build around those two guys, or those three guys, including Gordon Hayward. I actually feel like they can play together, and you know, that's a young team with a lot of pieces. They could make some moves and put the right guys around Ben Simmons and LaMelo Ball to where they can flourish. You know, so those it would be between Charlotte and Portland for me for my top two.
Okay, for the top two. So G, let me ask you a question, because you brought up Golden State, man, and I definitely agree with all of your points. But you're not gonna get Ben Simmons for free.
Right.
Will Golden State be willing to give up in order to obtain Ben Simmons?
I feel like they would definitely throw Andrew Wiggins in there, probably, most likely. I don't really see them touching Green. Maybe Draymond Green. I'm not 100% sure if they would or not. But if I'm thinking either Andrew Wiggins and Green or somebody else, like that would be the top two. I know they're not touching Clay and Steph. That they just stay there for life, I feel like. So it had to be between those two players. And Philly not going to give them up for nothing. You know, they're going to have to get something in return. They feel like they could, you know, help with Joel Embiid and the rest of that roster.
It's crazy because at one point in time, and Mel, I'm coming to you with this, man. At one point in time, man, we was looking at Ben Simmons' trade value. Like, you know what?
Yeah, it's crazy.
You can trade James Harden for Ben Simmons at a point in time. We was looking at that trade. That was a possibility. Mm-hmm. Now, Mel, you mentioned, you know, Portland and Charlotte, man. What is Portland willing to give up? Are you going to be able to keep Ben Simmons and still keep Dame and CJ? Or you got to give up at least CJ?
Yeah, I would think you had to give up CJ and then maybe somebody else as well. I forget what CJ's contract with Portland is like. I can't remember if he signed a max. I don't know what CJ McCollum's contract is like, but going on face value, I think you could probably just evenly swap out CJ for Ben Simmons. That's why I think that might be the ideal fit. Because like you said, if it's Golden State, which, again, I like him there, you'd probably have to give up James Wiseman, Draymond, you know, some of the younger pieces as well. So, but yeah, I think you could do an even swap probably with CJ and Ben Simmons. But that's just going off the top of the dome. I don't know what the contract situation is like.
All right.
I'm gonna go ahead and I'm gonna put my opinion. Philly.
Yeah.
Reason being, stay at home.
I feel as though now with that work ethic, I feel like you know, nobody is going to. It doesn't matter how much people around you is pushing you. If you don't want to push yourself, you're not gonna do it. And I feel like if he don't want to push himself in Philly, then he's not gonna want to push himself in Los Angeles. He's not gonna want to push himself in Charlotte. Now, don't get me wrong. I know change of scenery can definitely help, man. But if you are lazy and you don't have that kind of work ethic, you're gonna continue to have that. It's all up to him, pretty much, man. Pretty much. And honestly, man, I feel like if we gave Brett Brown all those years, there's no reason why you can't give Doc at least 2 years.
Mm-hmm.
At least 2 years. Doc just got there.
Yeah, definitely.
So I don't know if we sometimes overrate Doc, but if we believe Doc to be the coach that he is, at least give him that second year, at least. You know,
yeah.
Because honestly, man, I think it's just a mental thing with that man. Ben Simmons. I think it's just mental with that man, honestly. You know, it's just mental. It's just mental. Yeah. Because Ben knows his strengths. He knows his strengths. And he knows that, listen, I'm not about to be shooting these threes because I don't know how to shoot threes. Yeah, however, you have to at least have that mental capacity to say, I have belief enough that I can make this 15 footer. And how is that going to translate onto the court? Because we'll actually see you do it. This man averages 10 attempts, 10 and a half attempts and he hits at least five and a half. So we know that he's shooting 50% from the floor. But at the same time, bro, we need you to shoot a little more than 10. Like, you know, just take it one step at a time. Like, go ahead and hit 12.
Yeah.
14, you know? Because, again, man, if Ben can just get – we've always said this, just 15 feet. Bro, you don't got to shoot threes. 15 feet. 18 feet.
All right.
Well, you can do that. You can do that, brother. You can do that, man. So,
man, yeah, 15, 18 footer. Yeah, he'd be cold.
Right when you said it's a mental thing with him, I feel the same way. I really feel the same way. It's mentally more than anything else. You just gotta get his confidence back in.
Exactly. You know, I think Doc definitely deserves some blame because Doc has had too many collapses when it comes to the playoffs. So I'm not letting Doc just roam free right there. We know too many times, you know. But he can't play the game. He can't play the game, you know.
All right.
So, I'm gonna tell you right now, next season, Doc, you don't get it right, you gotta go, Doc. I don't know what they're gonna do, but come on, baby, come on, you know. So going into the third topic, man, who would you start a franchise with right now regarding everybody is healthy? Trae Young, Luka, or you going with D Booker? Mel, who you taking?
Such a tough decision. I know, such a tough decision, but I'm gonna go with D Book. Here's why. Not because, you know, he's one of the players still playing, but I feel like he has the highest ceiling. We see what Luka has done. You know, he was playing at an MVP level this year. We see what Trae is doing currently. You know, he's going into that superstar status, but I feel like Devin Booker's ceiling is just higher than both of those guys as far as, you know, his scoring ability, playmaking ability, and, you know, just having the ability to lead a team to, you know, where he's at right now, Western Conference Finals. And now, give a lot of credit to Chris Paul. They probably wouldn't be here without him. But I also think Devin Booker was coming into his own zone where he was going to be, you know, mentioned amongst the greats in the league. And we see it on a night-in, night-out basis, how he could just flat-out score and do a bunch of different things. So I would go with D Book. That's going to be my guy that I start a franchise with.
I respect that answer, man. Gotta respect. Honestly, there's really no wrong answer.
I know.
Really not.
It's a tough one. This is a super tough one.
It was.
The franchise.
It was a super tough one for me too, man. But like Mel said, man, I had to go with D Book as well. Because also, like he said, I feel like, you know, D-Book has the highest ceiling. Mm-hmm. I feel like D-Book is just entering his prime now, just realizing exactly who he is as a player. And people are starting to be put on notice, like, who he is and who he's really shown to be in the past 3 years now. Mm-hmm. He just finally getting that exposure, you know, being in the playoffs so everybody can see his game and what he really does on a nightly basis. He's really going to be one of those special all-time great players, I feel like, when it's all said and done. Looking at his body of work, how he plays, he definitely shows flashes of Kobe. I believe it was game two where he, like, hit – I don't know how many shots he hit in a row, but he just kept going down just draining them. Like it was like, you know, a Kobe spurt, how he just going down and, like, you know, I'm taking over this game, you know. He wasn't looking to pass. He was looking to score the whole time, you know. That was just like a whole totally flash of Kobe, you know. And I feel like, you know, he's definitely going to be one of those players, you know, when it's all said and done. And if he can get the job done this season and help Chris Paul win a chip, I mean, that's just going to add on to his legacy right there. And I feel like they very, very capable of doing it. I don't know who they're going to face in the East, whether it's Atlanta or Bucks. I'm pretty sure it's going to be the Bucks. But if he can get it done, man, I'm telling you, it's just going to be just the beginning for his career and legacy.
Man, again, man, it's really no wrong answer with this one, man. All three of those guys, man, I feel like is coming into their own. Respect to D Book, man, because I think sometimes he gets a little undervalued because we probably don't watch a lot of Suns game until just recently. I say recently, I mean like last year in a bubble, you know. Outside of that, man, D Book has been doing his thing. It just hasn't been translating to wins being in the Western Conference, you know? Right. So with that being said, man, I'm gonna have to go with, if I need to start one person as my franchise player, I'm gonna have to go with Luka. Luka is, he give people fits, man. He give people fits. And honestly, man, there's no game planning for a person like Luka. He has what he doesn't have, he can easily obtain it. So I'm gonna point out his weakness. A weakness that I feel like he has is his body and just getting in shape. Mm. He can change that. He can change that. And then the second one is, I'm going to say, is his passion / his temper when it comes to getting technical fouls. And I believe that, you know, that's passion for the game. Now, you know, we've seen greats like Rasheed Wallace, great player, right. But you know, his temperament sometimes got the best of him, but right. You knew that this is what you were getting when you had Rasheed Wallace on your team, Dennis Rodman, you know, mm-hmm. You knew that, listen, they were going to go back and forth with the refs. Ron Artest, great players who you knew that they was passionate about the game. So I don't really mind that too much. And I think what Luka has over those players is Luka is still young. So
that's true.
That can kind of he can change that criteria about himself versus those players were already kind of like stuck in their ways for the most part. You know, and I think, you know, it is just it'll take a J kid to realize, like, damn, okay, maybe I do need to make sure that I calm my temperature down, you know, because if I'm not in the game, I can't help my teammates. And I think J kid is really going to be that X factor for him to mentally really focus in and harness his passion into a different way instead of getting angry at the refs. There's no reason why your point guard is leading you in technical fouls. You got more technical fouls than Draymond.
All right.
Calm down. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Like, yeah, brother. You know what I mean? And honestly, to me, that's his only two weaknesses. That's it. Step back when it comes to points. I'm sorry. Free throws.
Oh, yes.
Yep. I'm sorry, free throws. I gotta mention free throws. There's no reason for that man to not be shooting at least at a 75% clip. Even though you a point guard, you really should be at 80%
free. Really?
But again, he can improve on those. He can improve on those, you know. Even if it's one of those situations where, you know, he get the whole he get J Kidd's whole free throw routine, he passing and kissing, you know what I'm saying? Like, I just think J Kidd is just gonna be so much of a big help to him. But it's nothing that Luka can't do, man. It's nothing that Luka can't do. And you know, shout out to Trae Young and Devin Booker, because I don't watch Suns and ATL games, but they are definitely putting me on notice. Like, I need to watch their games because they are something to see. I think Devin, you know what? Maybe they are. Devin Booker and Trae Young, they got to be box office.
Mm-hmm.
I love Devin Booker because Kobe seen something in him, and there's no reason why Kobe's going to see something in you for no reason. So I got to give it to D Book. And Trae, man, Trae had just been surprising the hell out of me. I don't know how you game plan against Trae because he keep coming. I don't care if he's 6-for-21. He will still keep shooting.
He will.
You know what I'm saying? So yeah, no wrong answer there, man. No wrong answer at all, bro.
Yeah, not at all.
It was tough, though. It was definitely tough.
It was tough, man. It was tough for real. Yeah. So going into the next topic, man, Kartavious Caldwell-Pope, who has 2 seasons left on his 3-year contract. I'm not going to mention how much money he's making because that's his business. But the Los Angeles guard was robbed at gunpoint early this month in a heist that netted over about $150,000 worth of luxury items. You know, definitely hope that he wasn't injured or, you know, his family wasn't hurt. You know, I just hope that he was able to walk away from that situation. I pray that, you know, everything is okay and nobody lost their life, man. But how do you guys feel about that?
Yeah, that was crazy. I actually read on that story just a couple of hours ago.
Mm.
And nobody was harmed in the incident, fortunately. And it's a crazy situation because they said that he was outside in his driveway talking amongst friends when these guys pulled up on him. So that's kind of suspect to me. Like, that sounds like an inside job a little bit to me. Like, you be outside your driveway. I don't know what type of north type of neighborhood he live in, but I'm assuming it's a gated community, you know, all the money he makes. So I'm just imagining how, you know, those guys would be able to run up on him like that in front of his house. But just thankful that, you know, nobody got hurt. You know, he got robbed, things got stolen, but so what? Those are things that could be replaced. His life can't be replaced. So at the end of the day, you know, just thankful nobody got hurt.
Yeah, I mean, that was my biggest takeaway. You know, you start seeing headlines like that, it's like you automatically feel like somebody lost their life. So the first thing I saw was he was okay. I honestly was like, all right, yeah, like F kind of the rest of the story, you know what I mean? Because we see far too often nowadays where, I mean, we don't even have to be artists or rappers, I mean, or ball players. It could be just regular people where they get, you know, stuck up and shot for no reason, you know what I'm saying? Innocent folks and just minding their business. So that's always the worst to me. Like, that's like super cowardly, you know what I mean? So thankfully, you know, he was okay. No one was hurt, but yeah, it's just a bunch of cowards, sounds like, and hopefully they find him so that way, you know, that something like that don't happen again or to somebody else. You know, the next person might not get lucky and survive that, you know. So
was this during broad daylight, or this is at night, or
I think they said it was around 4 a.m. So okay, it's pretty late.
Okay. Yeah, 4 in the morning. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Definitely, you know, big prayers to Caldwell Pope, you know, and you know, not prayers just because negative happened, man, but just in general, man. I feel like sometimes, man, we don't see prayers up until the negative has happened, or it's like quote unquote too late, man. So just prayers to everybody in general, you know. And just continue to be safe as much as possible, man. And to the people that did do this, man. One thing that Pops always told me was, it's never anything that another man is doing that you should be jealous about, because you can do the same thing even better. Mm-hmm. So all those, you know, materialistic items that you stole from that man, you could have got them yourself. A different, you know? Right. So yeah, man, definitely. So going into the next topic, man. Not enough education in public schools. Now, we know the lack of education has an impact on health, employment, gender, and exploitation. Mm-hmm. But at the time, man, you know, we have to get more in tune with, you know, financial literacy and things to that nature. Now, what you have in, you know, little princesses and princes that, you know, you raising to be profitable and successful kings and queens, man. How do you feel about this?
I mean, it's something I think about a lot, actually, especially being that my kids go to public school. You know, there's going to be a certain curriculum that they're taught. You know, a lot of the times, as we know, that curriculum is old and outdated. And just as an adult, you know, being somebody that's looking to buy a house or being somebody that's looking to apply for credit cards, I find myself not knowing what the hell I'm looking at most of the time. You know what I mean? And I think to myself, like, damn, what did I spend 12 years in school learning? Like, because I get algebra and stuff may be important, but at the same time, I haven't used it on my day-to-day, you know, life ever, you know what I mean? So, but when it comes to applying for, you know, a credit card, or when it comes to understanding finances or understanding tax rates and all of that stuff, you know, I'm finding myself doing the research, and I'm teaching myself now as an adult. So I just feel like we can get a jump start on that if we just start teaching kids early, you know what I mean? Whether it's in eighth or ninth grade, the experts can figure out which age is appropriate to start learning those types of things. But I know if we're smart enough to learn, you know, like I said, algebra or chemistry or geometry or any of those things, we're smart enough to learn about credit scores and whatnot. So, you know, this is definitely a topic I could talk about for days on, you know, but it's obvious that kids aren't really getting taught the necessary tools that we need to be taught to succeed in real life. You know what I mean? Because we all know as adults, you start running into things that we weren't, you know, that you just wasn't expecting and wasn't ready for. So, you know, school should be preparing us for this. So, again, something I can go on forever about, but yeah, it's there's definitely a lack of financial literacy in school, and it's disappointing for sure.
Mm-hmm. Definitely.
Fact right there. When it comes to school, man, and you know, not including college, just you know, taking it from kindergarten to
top grade.
What was one of the most boring classes that you felt like, this is boring, but this is going to make my life easier in the short and long term that I'm going to need?
I want to answer that too. I'll make it quick.
I mean, the only one that I would consider that was boring, but I felt like would actually help in my life would be algebra and geometry. Mm. Those are like probably the only two classes that I felt like, you know, this would be something that would benefit me later on. Mm. Other than that, anything else was just like, I don't know why I'm relearning this, you know, like world history. I mean, I know the importance of knowing your history, but you know, just the history that we were being taught at the time, just, you know, I feel like I didn't need to know, just learning about science and all that kind of stuff. I mean, I get chemistry and engineering, that type of stuff, but just learning about like biology and all that didn't feel like it was important for me. So yeah, algebra and geometry probably be like the two classes that I felt that was super boring, but these were classes I need to pay attention to.
Okay.
So yeah, it wasn't necessarily, it was during a math class. I remember they actually, they were teaching us about budgeting. Mm-hmm. And I remember we had like a group pod. It was a group project where we had like a certain amount of money, and then you had to do X, Y, and Z. And then, you know, you calculate what you had left at the end of it, basically. But I remember thinking like, damn, I remember thinking in my head vividly, like, I don't really like doing this. Mm-hmm. But damn, this seems super helpful. Like, this seems like this is going to be something that I'm going to be doing as an adult. Mm-hmm. And I wish I could remember what age I was, but yeah. And obviously that is something that we do as adults. I wish I could remember exactly what I learned, because I still have trouble budgeting nowadays. But yeah, I definitely remember that was, it was something I felt like, damn, okay, they teaching us something useful here.
Yeah, man. Yeah. I definitely say, business marketing, but my teacher was a little different. Like, you know, business marketing, a lot of people take business marketing because it's an easy class. You know, you probably get at least a B minus in it. And right. He was teaching us about stocks, man. And what we used to do every day is he would give us like a imaginary, like $1 million. And he used to say, I want you to divide this up into 25%. So put 25% here, 25% there, 25% there, 25% there. And now you got to watch it for the next 9 weeks, right? And this is when I realized that I was actually getting into it. So this is back, and this is like freshman, right? So this is like freshman, sophomore era. So this was back when I was on MediaTakeout.com every day. Every day I was on MediaTakeout.com. And I was looking out for, I don't remember the website that we used to look up at the time. Side note, I don't know how I was able to access MediaTakeout.com when they had certain websites that was restricted. I don't even know.
Right.
I don't even know. But I was logging on to that stock website so much that it was my most frequent page I visit, and like MediaTakeout was like the second. And that's how I was like, damn, man, this is I'm really like starting to like this, you know.
Yeah.
But you know, when we think about you know, critical thinking, creativity, communication, information, technology, all of these are different skills that are important and should be considered core skills, you know. Reason being is because every last one of them that I just mentioned, you can't succeed in this world without those skills, you know.
That's true.
So again, man, we need to recognize financial literacy as one of the core skills needed in the 21st century, man.
Mm-hmm.
you need him. Like Mel said, man, credit. Knowing
credit scores, all that.
Yeah. Like, that is so big. And one of the big things that I remember being in my environment, nobody cared about credit. You got people like now that don't care about the credit score because you got cash. However, having a credit score worth 800 points is like having $10 million in cash, you know? Mm-hmm. And it's just like things how we used to do, like don't answer the phone because it might be a bill collector, you know? Yeah. Or things like, don't worry about paying that bill because at some point in time, if we owe them money, they'll stay in business. Like, and it happens to be like generational because school isn't necessarily teaching it. You know, and I think about like how, you know, like conversations that like I had with my parents and they didn't necessarily know because it wasn't taught to them. And, you know, my nana might have not known because it wasn't taught to her, you know. So it's just like, damn, man, generation, generation, generation. And if you live in middle class or low class, that's usually the cycle. But if you are, you know, if you are raised in, you know, a wealthy family or a high class family, you already taught not to work for money.
Right.
Money work for you, you know?
Right.
I remember one of the things that I remember listening to Robert Kiyosaki, and he was like, if I pay you, you automatically think like an employee.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, damn, that's right. Whenever we think about getting more money, what's the first thing we think about?
Getting a job. Get a job.
You know what I'm saying? And it's just like, wow. Wealthy people, they understand that, okay, I have to make my money work for me. So how can I do that? Okay, let me employ other people to do it. Because I'm only one person. So I can't do everything. So I need to hire a person for this and hire a person for that, hire a person for this. Like, if we had, like, business entrepreneur classes and like, man, it's so much. We can honestly like spend like all day on this topic, man.
Really?
It's so important. And it's so sad that because we have public schools, it's like, you know, we're automatically starting like 10 feet behind. And then add on your environment. That's another 10 feet behind. Add on your race. That's another 30 feet behind. So it's just like, man, we already have all of these stripes against us. You know? Yeah. It just becomes tiring.
Yeah. It's crazy. Yeah. It's crazy because I didn't even learn what an asset and liability was until about 2 years ago. I didn't even know the difference between the two. Or what they meant, anything. Now I understand, like, you know, assets, having more assets is better than, you know, having all these liabilities and what you should do when you get money instead of, you know, buying a new car, which actually becomes a liability because that's money that you're going out paying, you know, each and every month instead of, like, you know, purchasing, like, a business or something like that or starting a small business and, you know, having that asset grow for you. This is something I just learned 2 years ago. Didn't know anything about. So definitely, that's something that we need to improve on moving forward.
That's a fact, man. I mean, I think about like, you know, when I first started trading, which is going on 3.5 years, almost 4 years, man, you know, and just like being able to read like a NFP week and being able to read like, okay, this is the amount of jobs that is in the U.S. or this is the amount of jobs that the president created for the U.S. in the last month. Things like you said, assets and liability. Like, how many of us go crazy for some Jordans?
Right.
That's a liability. Like, those don't appreciate with value. They depreciate, you know? Mm-hmm. How many of us want the car in the next year? It's 2021 right now. We want to get a 2022. As soon as you drive off the lot, it's a depreciating asset. But you look at some artwork and you realize, oh, let me hold on to this. Because it's going to be worth a great amount of value in the future. Or you look at keeping land, like
anyone
who I know that like land has been in their family for like generation, keep it. They should be, and I know that the money is very tempting. You and your family own a piece of land. Do you know how in our community? Do you know how rare that is? You own a piece of land. Like, that's beautiful. Like, you can, that's for your kids, 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 kids. Like, you may not even know, like, your kids, 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 but they going to know that Grandpa Pop Mel had had this. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. So, and it's like, it's yeah, it's a piece of the land, but it's a piece of the earth. Like, it's forever yours. Like, that's
it's not yours. The city.
Yeah.
And not just the housing structure, the land.
The land. It's the land itself. Yeah.
This is land that our ancestors were slaves. Mm-hmm. And before that, they wasn't even here. And before that, they wasn't even slaves. Like, so it's just a beautiful thing, man. And again, man, we could talk all day
about this topic we gotta go back to, definitely.
Hopefully, man, you know, well, not
before you guys forget, please make sure to hit that subscribe button, like, comment, and share. Again, stay in touch with us for all updates.